It's the Gentiles and the Jews. That's the only two women in the whole Bible.
Raise your hand.
What do you think she was? Do you think she was of Sarah or Hagar?
I don't know. Sarah.
Sure you do. I'm going to read you a verse and you'll know instantly. Let me read you a verse.
I might not be here till like 8 at 20.
She
should go to bed early.
Okay.
So, work tomorrow.
Yeah.
Loving it. Do you read that with another Bible alongside that? Sometimes I'll, if I have a problem
turn that
verse, I'll check it out. It can be pretty challenging at times.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, there we go, record.
Okay. Here you go. This for you, Pauline.
Okay.
We're in Galatians.
Galatians.
Galatians, chapter 4. We'll start at verse 21. I'll let you find it first.
Galatians.
What? I guess I can.
Oh, it's that New Testament towards the back. I don't know if it's before or after. I think it's.
Did you understand? Did you?
I don't think so. What did you do?
It's between Corinthians.
Just move faces of the camera.
Okay.
What's that?
Corinthians and.
I was just being funny.
So just.
I was being funny to the
camera.
Put her face in it.
No, you can.
Chapter 4.
I'm gonna pick out today.
No.
Four. What number?
Why submit to?
They're mine.
Chapter 4.
Chapter 4, what?
Start at verse 21.
Okay, I got it.
You got it?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll read it for you and you just follow along. Tell me, you who want to be under the law, are you not aware of what the law says? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by the slave woman and the other by the free woman. His son by the slave woman was born in the ordinary way, but his son by the free woman was born as a result of the promise. These things may be taken figuratively. For the women represent two covenants. One covenant is from Mount Sinai and bears children who are to be slaves, that is Hagar. Now, Hagar stands for Mount Sinai in Arabia, and corresponds to the present city of Jerusalem, because she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem that is above is free, and she is our mother. For it is written, "Be glad, O barren woman who bears no children, break forth and cry aloud, you who have no labor pains. Because more are the children of the desolate woman than of her who has a husband. Now you, brothers, like Isaac, are children of promise." That should be enough to jiggle our minds.
I think the next verse has a lot of important.
Read it for us.
"But as he who was born according to the flesh then persecuted him, who was born according to the Spirit, even so it is now."
Same.
Excellent. Yeah, we needed that verse.
Yeah.
So you have those of the Spirit. The Spirit is truth. The Spirit of truth is love. And we have those of rules and regulations, written codes, the Gentiles.
Dictates.
More or less. Do the Gentiles not live by law? We have laws in Canada, United States, Hungary. Russia has laws. Those are not the laws we live by, though, is it? If you keep our law, the royal law,
love God.
Truth and love, love God, love your neighbor as yourself, what Gentile law are you ever going to break? You'll never break a law. Would you steal from someone if you believe in Jesus, would you play the thief? Steal someone's skidoo? Steal someone's wife? Steal someone's child? Kidnap them? Would you do that if Jesus was in you? No. So you'll never be held accountable for those laws. Let me see. Would you ever rob a man if Jesus dwells in you? I'm going to get a little more poignant now, so get ready. Would you ever rob a person if Jesus dwells in you? Paul said, you who claim to keep the law, do you rob temples? What's he talking about? We're the temple of the Holy Spirit. Jesus accuses the Pharisees of being the temple of Satan. What does it mean to rob a temple? Ever steal a man's dignity? I'm afraid I've been guilty of doing that. Not proud of it. When I became aware of it, that I wasn't quite as righteous as I thought I was. And I'm just giving you one example. I could give you hundreds. I realized that, wow, the Bible's right. No one is righteous, no, not one. Our righteousness is as filthy rags compared to God's righteousness. And yet a lot of people really put themselves on a pedestal and think that they're so righteous. When, my goodness, when they find out what's in this book and what this book explains, they're going to be on their faces asking for forgiveness. But it'll be too late. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to be on our faces asking for forgiveness, because we all need it. I still struggle sometimes. I still get caught. I still sin and get upset with people, because people can be such assholes.
Sometimes, eh?
And sometimes they just, put it this way, I just need to put them in their place. Bring them down a notch or two, just because they're being such assholes. And I do it. Is it right? No. No, I'm not defending myself. I got no defense. I'm just as guilty of sin as everybody else. So, this Sarah and Hagar, they're the only two women in the Bible. I forgot what the point of the Sarah and Hagar was.
Well, Mary Magdalene.
Mary Magdalene.
So Mary Magdalene.
Would Mary Magdalene be a woman who was a woman of the promise?
I don't know.
Or do you think Mary Magdalene was a woman of Hagar, a slave to law?
She must have been a slave.
To
begin with, yeah, she had seven demons casted out of her, yeah. Right? But at the end, she
remember
was
those demons, eh? The opposite of the seven spirits of God are those seven demons that came out of Mary Magdalene.
Okay.
Grace, the spirit of grace, the first spirit of God that we learn. Well, what would be the opposite of the spirit of grace?
No forgiveness.
No forgiveness at all. What's that? What's the word?
Contempt.
Contemptive?
Yeah. Yeah, that holds everybody in contempt. Judgmental.
Yeah. Judgmental, yeah. No grace whatsoever.
Yeah.
That demon had to come out. Because Mary Magdalene is the one that brought to my homeland, Gaul, which is now France. She brought the good news of the gospel to the shores of France. And they still, to this day, at Magdala...
Magdalene? I don't know.
It's a town in France, on the shores of France. They celebrate to this day. Now, they've got it messed up. There's no question about it. I mean, the language we speak and hear written in this book is not the language the world speaks and hears. They don't hear things the way we do. So they take it all literal. So they think that Mary Magdalene came to the shores of France with a little girl named Sarah. Oh, well, I just showed you Sarah. Yeah, she came with a little girl named Sarah, And Sarah was just beginning. Yes, she was young. It's like, how old am I in the gospel? Well, I'm about 35 years old in the gospel, in the correct gospel. I'm a lot older than that, if I take it back to when I was born. But I'm about, you know what I mean? Well, Sarah, when Mary Magdalene brought Sarah to France, was just beginning. The gospel was just beginning to spread out into the world, you know? But Mary Magdalene brought the gospel to the shores. And there's a wonderful story of Mary Magdalene and this little community that celebrates her coming. They have no idea anymore. It's been lost in the centuries as to what the whole story represents, but they still celebrate it. So in the beginning, Mary Magdalene would have been of Hagar because she had the seven demons. Did Mary Magdalene believe in God? Did she understand that God is truth and that Jesus is Lord? When he first met her, she had seven demons in her. No, no, he wasn't God. She didn't even believe in God. That was all BS to her, you know? But that changed. She became very close in the disciples group.
One of the three Marys, eh?
Yeah.
Were mentioned, yeah.
Yeah. Did she fear God? No, she was a prostitute. You ever see a prostitute that feared God? My goodness, prostitutes don't get, they don't fear getting, I'm going to take it even into the literal, they don't fear getting STD, what's an STD?
Sexually
transmitted disease. They don't worry about that. They ride bareback all the time, think nothing of it. They get sick, they go to the doctor, or they die. I mean, diseases like syphilis in the Civil War wiped out more soldiers than bullets did. You know what I mean? Yeah, that's true. So she had no grace. She didn't believe in God or that Jesus was God. She had no fear of God. Did she have any wisdom or understanding from God? No. No. But she taught my people. She taught my ancestors. Did she understand the spirit of judgment the way we do? No. Was she a judgmental bitch? Oh boy, was she ever. You betcha. So you see the opposites of the sevenfold spirit are the seven heads of the beast. The opposites of the sevenfold spirit are... what, I've lost it again. What we were talking about
Mary
Magdalene, whether she was of Sarah or Hagar. But why did I start with the menorah?
Well, because you're giving the seven demons the opposite of the seven-headed beast, right?
That's right, the seven demons that came out of her. That was the link I'd forgotten, was the seven demons and the seven heads of the beast are one and the same. This is why they don't say that there was 21 demons came out of Mary Magdalene or out of anybody, you know, or why wasn't there 1,000 demons come out of her? Well, no, only the seven had to come out. She became one of the apostles of Christ. Just the seven had to come out. Did she have counsel and power in the spirit of God? Did she have counsel and power? Oh, most definitely. In the world, I never met a prostitute in my life that wasn't very intelligent and could give you sound counsel and power, considering the ways of the world. I was a prison guard for most of my life, that's why I know prostitutes. So, you think of this, and was she on fire for God? Was the truth being revealed from her lips about God? About salvation, about eternal life, about the book of life, about what's in the Bible? No. Was she on fire? Oh yeah, the fire that was in her set her on fire, all right. Destroyer. Remember, there's a couple of fires in the Bible. There's the fire of God and there's the fire of man. And they ain't the same. The fire of God will put you for, through the, remember Daniel and in the line, no, it wasn't Daniel, it was Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. And when the king looked in, there was a fourth standing amongst them. And the king said, he looks like a son of man. Another man in there. Another guy. Of course, we understand it was our God. It was Jesus in there with them. But the fire didn't touch them. Well, that was an earthly fire. God's fire is not an earthly fire. It's a fire that burns to the very bowels of the lake of fire. It's the truth revealed. It doesn't go away. Once it's in a person, it'll either deliver them or it'll destroy them. And that's something to remember when you decide, when you become trained warriors and you decide to go to battle. Remember that. If your sword is sharp, razor sharp, if it glints, it's so sharp. When you draw it, remember the sword is the word of God. It's the truth coming out of your mouth that you're explaining to people. When you draw it, it'll get in, and they won't be able to get it out. I guarantee you, as much as you try to forget what I've shown you, you will never forget it. You will never forget it. As much as you desire to get rid of it, I'm not saying any of you would be like that, but some people are like that. They wanna belly up to the bar, so to speak. They wanna get in your face and spit at you. They wanna tell you that they're right and you're wrong. Just remember, when you draw that sword and you swing it, there's no escaping it. There's no escaping it. So sometimes, I tell you this just so you're aware, don't be too quick to draw the sword. Don't be too quick. Give people an opportunity to listen. Give people an opportunity to understand before you swing.
Jesus said that with the Pharisees, slowly rebuked them more and more. It started off pretty light compared to the end.
Yeah. You're not there to destroy them. Remember the dudes that Peter, James, and John were with Jesus, and they were going through a village, and the village didn't want them to stay. They move on, they said. And the three disciples asked them, they said, Lord, would you like us to call fire down from heaven and destroy them? And the Lord said, you don't know by what spirit you speak. Don't forget, he called St. Peter Satan.
Satan, yeah.
He called him Satan. When Peter denied that, you know, Jesus is telling them, you know, it's almost time, I got to go up to Jerusalem, and there I'll meet my end. They'll arrest me. They will crucify me unto death, but don't worry, on the third day I'll rise. And Peter took Jesus aside, you know, and he said, come on, Lord, don't talk like that. People love you. They want to make you king. Don't talk like that. That's not going to happen. And Jesus' reply to that,
get behind me, Satan.
Get behind me, Satan. You have not in mind the things of God. What's written in here, you're thinking of things of man. He called him Satan. That's St. Peter. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? People say, oh, the devil didn't dwell in me. I'm so holy and righteous. Right. Boy, you're better than St. Peter? Wow, you really think highly of yourself. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
I think the devil's quite at home in that person. Yeah. Nicely settled.
It's you know, it's all part of the deception. You can be like God, you know, you can be perfect. Well, that's a lie. We are not like God. We are not God. We struggle in our humanity, every single one of us. Every one of us has a breaking point. It's another thing to remember about people. Everyone has a button. Every one of us. People say, oh, no, I'm in control, I can do it. I guarantee you, I can push buttons on you that you will explode. You'll piss yourself, you'll be so mad. Everyone has buttons.
Don't do that.
Don't push people's buttons. Don't. Because people think that, oh no, he's a Christian, he won't hit me. He's just full of shit. Talks big, but he'd never do anything. Don't count on it. Everybody's got buttons.
Sure.
Everybody, women, men, even children have buttons. It says in the scriptures to fathers, it says, don't exasperate your children. Don't do that. You're just pushing their buttons. You're just making them hate so you can have what you want, so you can play God. You're just making them hate. Don't do that. And love your children. There's nothing wrong with discipline. I'm not saying that. I'm saying, is the word exasperate?
I have not heard you use that before.
No, I know the verse you're talking about. I can't remember where it is.
I know. That's in, it's Paul that's saying this, and it's always safe to say Paul.
I think it's Old Testament, but that's okay. Yeah. It's probably New Testament too. But well, you get
I'll
my
look
drift.
It up. I'll
you
look
get my
it.
Drift. It's all part of it, and it's, you know.
Fathers don't, we bring it up, fathers don't.
You're going to get about 50 freaking verses on that. Us computer users, you know.
That's the word exasperate.
Oh, really?
Exasperate.
Eh?
Fathers do not exasperate.
Exasperate.
Bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord.
Yeah. Don't exasperate. Don't push their buttons. Don't push their buttons. I've seen so many parents and they bitch and bitch and bitch and bitch at their children.
Don't do that. Don't do that. How many times have I been telling you don't do that? My goodness, you're just always doing that. Why don't you stop doing that?
They're exasperating them. It would be much kinder to take the little beggar, bare his butt, put him over your knee and give him a swat.
Get over it.
Get it done with. Than you would be to keep nagging at him. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's more righteous to corporal discipline it than to keep
mentally exhausted.
Poking him. You know what I mean? It just doesn't work. It doesn't work. But that's another story. I told you last week, I really want to go into this spirit of fire.
Yeah.
Because Laodicea is important. So let's find Laodicea and let's read that.
I'm here if you want.
Who's got a King James? Murray, here's the King James.
Mm-hmm.
Do you mind reading the Laodicea for us? Tell me where you are, though. I don't know where it is.
It's 3 verse 14.
Yeah.
Chapter 3.
Yeah.
Verse 14. Just a minute.
Right.
But have you found it yet?
It's right here.
You got it now?
Yeah.
Okay, starting it. Nice and loud for everybody, okay? The camera can't hear you if you don't.
And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things have the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, and that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with good, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to be
Buy.
Buy of my gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come unto him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me on my throne, even as I also overcome. And I am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches.
Amen. That church is a real mind blower,
isn't it?
There is more information that has been suppressed by organized religion in that church. They don't want you to know what it means. Well, guess what? I'm going to explain to you what it all means. We're going to might as well start at the beginning, and we'll just cruise on through it. I'm using the NIV. I think it'll, well, it does. It lines up really, really well with the King James. It says, to the angel of the church of Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. Who's that?
Jesus.
It's Jesus. The faithful witness in Scripture is Jesus. Now I'm gonna pull a little bit here so you can add some things on the corner shelf to look at later. The faithful witness is Jesus. The faithful witness in the night is Jesus. The moon is the faithful witness in the night. It's Jesus. So when the moon is turned to blood, which is contempt, it ain't talking about an atmospheric condition.
Judgment Day.
Contempt is, blood is contempt. The moon is turned to contempt. Remember what we were discussing there just a little while ago, a few minutes ago, and we were talking about how people, the truth really, really upsets some people. You, as you bring forth the truth, it offends people. Because they thought they understood something, but what you're saying doesn't agree with what they think they understand. So it kind of pisses them off. They get upset. This is why they want to push you away. They don't want you to hang. You know, they don't want to hear what you got to say. Their hearts are not really sincere with God. Their hearts are very sincere with organized religion, the whore, doctrine. They're very sincere with what they've been taught as children in their organized religion, no matter what religion it is. I'm not just picking on Christendom. It doesn't matter. We could have Jews, Orthodox Jews sitting here. We could have Islam sitting here. We could have Hindus sitting here, Christians sitting here. It doesn't matter. Same thing applies. People are very quick to defend what they think is right, because it's what they were taught. Everyone must be born again. Not of organized religion. It's not a matter of being born again from, oh, I was an Orthodox Jew and now I'm a Christian, praise the Lord. Huh? That's not being born again, son. Well, I was a Roman Catholic. This is very popular on the internet because so many people think that Roman Catholicism is the Pope is the Antichrist sort of deal. That's a load of bullshit. Okay? Just so that's on tape. That's not true.
organized religion. You're all born again. So Catholics converting to Protestantism.
Yeah, a Catholic converted to Protestantism. That's not being born again. Jesus said everyone must be born again of what? Of truth and love unto the gospel of God and his Christ. That is the gospel contained in this book. That's the gospel Paul preached. That's the gospel Peter preached. That's the gospel Moses preached. That's the gospel Abraham preached. It never changes. It's always the same gospel. Never changes. In Abraham's day, it was the gospel of God. Follow him. God was truth, and his spirit was love. Even in Abraham's day. How did Jesus talk? He was talking to somebody. Can't recall who, but he said, you know, if Abraham were your father, you wouldn't treat me the way you're treating me. Hi, Dan.
Hey,
sorry.
Hey, Dan.
You wouldn't be treating me this way. Abraham never did the things you do. You want to kill me. Abraham never did that. Abraham didn't want to kill anybody. They even stole his wife. Pharaoh stole his wife. And Abraham got on his face and cried out to God that she come back whole to his arms. You guys want to kill me. Interesting, eh? What God did Abraham serve? Truth and love. Truth and love. Same God. So, at this, I'm going to pull it back up and we'll get into it again.
Welcome.
It's a good problem.
The faithful witness in the night is the moon. So the moon turning to blood is the moon being held in contempt. If Jesus is the moon, you're going to find this gospel very much held in contempt. Be prepared. That's all I can say. Be prepared. Told you last week. I'm not trying to get you to come to me. I'm trying to show you, give you tools that you can go back and help those folks you love. I don't know them. You know them. They're your loved ones. They're your friends and neighbors. I don't know them. I'm just a donkey living in the bush. I don't know nobody but a bunch of chickadees. And you guys. So, you're going to meet with a lot of resistance. It's just, it's human nature. If a person is taught something all of their life and they think it's the right thing and everything, and then they find out, oh crap, I'm finding out this guy's talking about it. He's reading it out of the book and everything, and I know I got my religion from the book, but it's not lining up with what I thought, and they get obstinate. They get obstinate. So be gentle. Don't be too quick to draw that sword. You don't want to put anybody to death. But you can't. You can't. We go farther. Verse 15. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. Now here's the clincher on this. There's a clincher in understanding this statement. I wish you were either one or the other. This is God speaking. This is later on in Revelation. It tells you that this angel who's speaking to John is Jesus. He says, I wish you were either cold or hot. Does God wish anyone go to hell? No. God's will is that all be saved. He doesn't cherish the thought of anybody going to hell. But we have free will. And he's not going to stand in our way. You know what I mean? He's not going to... We're not robots. We make our choice as to what we want. We choose our destiny. We judge ourselves. Which is what the word said. If the word is the judge, then how does that work? We receive the word. Do we accept it or do we reject it? The word is the judge. And the word tells us what happens to us if we reject it. And the word tells us what happens to us if we accept it. And Jesus is the word in flesh. I wish you were hot or cold. I have heard thousands of people tell me that that means that we can either, God wishes we were either unbelievers or believers. Does that make any sense?
No.
Not a bit.
Not a bit, no.
Not a bit. No sense at all. So it's not that. Wish you were hot or cold. And his criticism? Look at his criticism. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. Oh crap. Now what's going on? I'm going to, please don't take any offense to my, what I'm about to say. Don't take offense. It's not meant in that manner. Murray is not a man of many words. Pauline is not a lady of many words. But we know that both Murray and Pauline love the Lord dearly. I used to go to church with this man. Years ago. Because a person is not quick to speak, doesn't mean their heart is not right with God. Because a person, many things make a person not feel comfortable saying anything. Past things in our lives. I understand that, so does God. So if you were looking at Murray and Pauline, we love them dearly and we know that they're God-fearing believers. But when it comes to, they're not out in the streets, you know, they're not quick to say anything. They're not screaming from the rooftops. They're not public figures. So one might say their fire, which they do possess the fire of God, but their fire is kind of cool. Cool. Does God hate them for it? Not a chance. Not a chance. They're just as important. They're just as strong a witness. They're just as powerful as any of us. But their fire is cold. Do you understand that, Mer? Do you understand, Clint? I do not say that in criticism.
No.
Don't take that as a criticism. We're trying to understand why God says, I wish you were hot or cold. It has to mean something different than being a believer or an unbeliever. For being someone who is ashamed of God in comparison to someone who's not ashamed of their God. It is not talking about that. God does not wish anyone to go to hell. God does not wish ill on anyone. The Spirit of God is love. So we're just explaining what's hot and what's cold. That's all we're doing. Not a criticism. Okay, so what's hot? Ever stand beside a fire?
It's warm.
You know? Well, you know, the white man, he built a big fire stand way back. Indian a little smarter. Don't use as much wood. Make a little fire stand closer.
Right. Ah.
One's a little cooler than the other, isn't it? And one's a little hotter. What is this hot and cold?
So is this like the soapbox you're trying to say there a little bit?
No, a soapbox is when I, you know me. When I start getting excited, that's just, no, that's, no, it's not a soapbox.
No, but a big fire, like
I'll add more. Okay. I'll add some more. In a hot fire, you need a lot of wood. In a cooler fire, you don't need as much wood. You don't need as much coals, burning coals. You remember the burning coals that the angel takes from within the embers, and he touches the prophet's lips with them. And he says, now that this has touched your lips, you will speak loud and clear. You know what I mean? These burning coals from in there, you know, well, let's move away from our group. I have known and know folks who are not as quick mentally as what society calls the norm. We use the word retarded, we use the word slow learners, we use the word, I think you get my drift. Are those folks any less than you or I? Are they are they to be thought of as lower on the evolutionary scale? No. You know, because their IQ is not as high perhaps, you know? Pat's IQ a little higher than mine.
I doubt it.
You know what I mean? Does that make me less of a person? Because he's smarter than I am? No. Does God love the person with the lower IQ less than the genius? No. Not at all. He made them all. He made us all. So, just because a person is of an IQ that has difficulty, I remember kids that I went to school with in public school, and their IQ was not as high. They were all my friends and everything. We had a great time together, but they had a real difficult time learning. School, you know, textbooks, even the Bible. They had a hard time with it. They weren't gifted with that. I had a friend lived down the street from me, two sons. One son was really, really struggling in school. Nice kid, but he was really struggling in school. They put him in a slow learner's class. They got him special teachers and all this kind of stuff, change of curriculum, all this stuff. Yeah, but his other son, his younger son, was a real whiz. He is a mathematical genius. He did great in school. So you've got these two kids, two sons of a man. And I'm sitting there talking to the man one night, and he says, I don't know what to do with, let's call them Bill and Bob. Bob's the smart one, Bill's not as quite as bright. He says, I don't know what to do with Bill. I don't know what to do with them. They've got them in special classes now. They've got them, you know, on all this weekend work and all this kind of stuff. And he says, I just don't know what to do with the kid. And I said, you know, I said, I think you're giving too much credit to all these morons who sit in the places of power and think they know something. I said, we're Christians. We don't think the way they think. I says, you, Bill, I said, when you're outside, my friend was a class 7 welder, high as you can get. I said, when you're outside welding, at home he's always tinkering, you know, and building stuff, even for me. And I said, who's always there with you helping? Bill. I said, when you need a half inch open end spanner, I said, do you have to draw Bill a picture? No. I said, well, what do you ask for? A half-inch open-end spanner. And I said, Bill, he's got to go all the way down, and we're outside in the garage, he's got to go all the way down to the basement to the big toolbox to find it. Does he come back with a half-inch open-end spanner? Yeah, of course he does. Oh, I thought he was a slow learner. Well, yeah, but that's different. That's different? Wait a minute. That's not different. I said, seems to me, I said, you should be encouraging Bill in the things that Bill is most attuned to assimilate, to understand. I said, you know, the Russians have been doing this for years. They take their children and they recognize their aptitude, what they're good at, what they like, and that's the course of study that they put their children through. So if a kid's dad is a carpenter and the kid is absolutely in love with his dad and absolutely loves carpentry, don't try and make a scientist out of him.
Right.
Teach him to be a carpenter, and he'd be a real good carpenter. Do you know, that's 40 years ago. Those two boys today, Bill's the most successful. Mm. He's a class 7 welder like his dad at Inco. Is it Inco in Sudbury?
Could be, yeah, Inco.
Inco,
yeah.
Isn't it? Yeah. The big mine in Sudbury. He made more money than his brother, but his brother was the genius. I'm not saying his brother's not doing well. He's doing well too. But
The point
is that some people may not be that quick to pick up even the things I'm teaching. Pick up some of it, but maybe not all of it. Because they don't, not quite built to that aptitude. That makes them no less. In fact, it makes them more, they should be more important to us. Because we see and we recognize they need protection. They need protection. So if they do find themselves in a situation and we're there close by and we see them struggling, we'll help. We'll jump right in and help. We stand together. We don't stand, they're comrades. We don't stand separated. We stand together. We hold the same sword. And we both use it. And we'll help one another. So cold and hot. Is cold and hot starting to take on a new
meaning,
perspective, understanding of what cold and hot is? Because he said, I wish you were either cold or hot. But because you're lukewarm, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. Now, what the hell does that mean? The lukewarm ones are pretty simple to recognize. They don't have an excuse for being stupid. They don't have that excuse.
A hot fire is when you got to keep building on, and a cold fire, it's a different way of building it, but you still have to build it that way. Lukewarm is when you lit and you just left it. And
just it's left just it cold. To smolder. Put a little wood on it, leave it to smolder.
That's a good point.
Well, I never really did read the Bible. I've been in church for 40 years, and I'm an elder in the church, and I'm a Sunday school teacher, but I never really did read the Bible all the way from front to back. What's that?
Put your hand on it, I bet you it's still hot.
Not very. Not very. I haven't run into anyone yet.
He's talking about an actual fire poles.
Yeah, but
fire.
In the spirit, we're not talking about, you know, a bonfire or a little fire. We're talking about the spirit here. A person can be... People have a real tendency of trying to think of the word where something sits so long that it goes bad.
Mold.
Yeah, rotten, spoils, spoiled, stale, dated.
Stale.
Yeah, stale, yeah.
People will sit in church in the pew and listen to the same sob story from the pulpit over and over and over for years and years and years. Never anything new.
They start to atrophy, you know, their muscles.
Yeah, atrophy.
Yeah, atrophy. Yeah.
Years and years of. Well, yeah, we like to sing more than anything else because there is nothing else. And that's what it's boiled down to today.
Right. So this hot or cold, I can hear what you're saying. I understand what you're saying. But is there a scriptural reference where you pulled that from or where you came up to this concept?
Yeah, there is. There's lots of them.
Well, what word would you look up? Hot and cold?
You wouldn't look up hot and cold.
No.
You won't find it.
Okay.
You won't find it. No. You have to go. You have to understand, remember, this is the final spirit. We're at the end of the most important study you'll ever partake of in your life. We're at the end of it. It's not complete as far as there's a whole rest of Revelation to understand yet that applies, goes along with it, but those seven spirits tell the whole story. The letters to the seven churches tell the entire story from the beginning of Revelation to the end of Revelation. They tell the whole story from the beginning of Genesis to the end of Revelation. Those seven spirits tell the whole story. So there's more to go with it, but in understanding the first six, that hot and cold in the seventh just becomes blatantly apparent. You know what I mean?
Because it's dealing with...
We'd have to sit down. How long... Did you read Bestiary? Or do you have Bestiary?
Not with me, but I have it at
home. That's okay. Yeah. So you understand what I'm talking about when I talk about that book. How long did it take you in reading the book and checking the scriptural references? How long did it take you to realize that... Wow, there is another meaning in the Bible.
Well, I already had a bedrock laid kind of from the study. It was like almost a year.
Yeah.
So it's fairly quickly, but that's because there's already a foundation being laid.
Okay. If there hadn't been a foundation
laid? It would have taken a while. I may not have finished reading the book. Maybe not. Because when it started coming, I wanted to refute this stuff.
Good, good. That's...
Or be a balance between
that's
him
a good
and
reaction.
God. And as I set out to refute it, my own views became refuted.
What's the name of the book?
Yeah.
Ed's book. You don't have a copy?
No.
Oh, give me one.
How many do you
have? I don't know if it books. It should be empty, but it ain't empty yet. I don't know. No, that is a lousy answer for a good question on hot and cold.
Where's that book?
You know. But I'm afraid I can't give you
but
any
specific...
But
if I go through my concordance and look through all hot and all cold out...
You won't find it.
No,
you won't find it. It just... It's one of those things that you have to see... What has come in the past? You have to understand, number one, the gospel of God and his Christ very, very well before you can really understand what this verse is talking about. Has anybody here ever heard hot and cold explained the way I just explained it before?
Just by Katy Perry.
These be my ringtone, right?
Really fast. What's hot and what's cold? I missed half it. So what is hot? Just fast words and what is cold?
Just a summary. You want
a
little
lukewarm.
Summary of hot and cold.
So hot
and
is
lukewarm.
Hot and cold are too good, but lukewarm is really bad.
Yeah, this
lukewarm
was
is terrible. You're in trouble if you lukewarm.
So hot, well,
or cold is good. Hot or cold is
well,
good.
Cold is all no God. Hot,
no, that's what he exactly that. He was started off pointing out where that's where a lot
just
of people have
example.
Been taught
what,
that.
What is hot to you and what is cold? Just fast. Hot is.
Well,
just a fast saying for I could understand it quickly.
Passion.
Hot is an apostle.
There you go.
Yeah. Like Joyce.
Cold is an idiot. Sitting down at the back pew. You wanted it in a nutshell. There it is. And when I say an idiot, I don't mean that disrespectfully. I mean that as a person with a very, very low IQ that understands nothing of the scriptures. He's in the back pew, the apostle standing at the front showing everybody everything. There's hot and cold. God loves them both, and he loves them both equally.
Yeah, but they're both in church.
Eh?
They're both in church. What is...
That's what
he's
saying.
Well, it doesn't matter if they're in church. It matters.
It's because his understanding, he was always taught that cold meant you didn't believe,
mm-hmm.
and hot meant you believed. And that's what he was starting the conversation with that misunderstanding, right?
It's not true.
It's not true.
And did you catch why I said it's not true?
Yeah, I understood.
Because the scriptures say, I wish, God speaking, I wish you were either hot or cold. God wishes no one to be ignorant of the gospel. God wishes no one to go to hell. God loves his creation. He does not glory, or how would you say, he doesn't rejoice at the destruction of the wicked.
Mind if I say something?
Yeah.
I mean, I hear what you're saying, and I'm not refuting it. Just kind of letting things float around in my head.
Yeah.
But originally, to me, lukewarm meant that you've heard the gospel, but you're not doing anything with it.
Well, that's what, yeah.
That is.
It's very close.
Yeah.
Close, okay.
Yeah.
But, like, also, I mean, even trying to talk to people, I guess, evangelizing and stuff like that.
Hey, can you use...
Remember, though, it's not always us getting out there and becoming evangelists.
Yes.
That's not the point. The point is understanding. The point, the gift of God. 1 John 5:20. The gift of the Holy Spirit is understanding God and what he wants of us. That's the gift of the Holy Spirit. Understanding what's written in this book. That's his gift to us. In that gift, we find salvation. We find the narrow path. We find deliverance. We find protection. We find how to walk among everyone, righteous and wicked. Our safety is found in that understanding. Jesus is that understanding in us. Like everybody says, well, Jesus is in me. Well, if Jesus is in us, shouldn't Jesus' wisdom be in us as well? Shouldn't we be learning from him? He says, I'm coming back as the counselor. You know, I will ask the Father, and the Father will give you another counselor. And the Spirit of truth. He will not leave you. He will be with you forever. Don't worry. I won't leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Who is the Spirit of truth? It's Jesus. He just told us that. He tells us that.
Remember the code you were talking about last week, Ruth? Can you see the code? I will ask the Father. He is the Father. In flesh. And he will send you another counselor to be with you forever. The Spirit of truth. And then he turns around and he says, I will not leave you as orphans.
All together, eh?
I will come to you. Who's the Spirit of truth? It's Jesus. Who's the counselor? It's Jesus. When I see people who have claimed that Jesus is in them, and they're as dumb as dirt, and they don't have an excuse, they got high IQs that are up here, but they're as dumb as dirt, they don't understand anything that's in the scriptures, I see lukewarm. And that is a dangerous place to find yourself. It's a place you don't want to stay there. You don't want to stay there. Either burn your... Oh, no, I won't say that.
I just got an idea. I mean, I might stand corrected, but I think a really good illustration for the hot or cold or lukewarm is the parable of the talents.
Mm-hmm.
The person who... invested what was given to him, and it produced much compared to the one who gave what he had placed it. Well, yeah, the cold.
He was given the talent, right? But he took the talent, bundled it up in a rag to protect it,
mm-hmm.
and buried it.
Yeah.
And what did the master say to him when he come back? Everybody else has multiplied what has been given them. What has been given us is understanding. What do we do with it? I mean, you asked me last week, what really made a change in my life? And I said, Jeremiah 5:4.
Oh, yeah.
These are only the poor. They do not know God, nor understand his command. I had been taught my entire life that the poor were those with no coin in their pocket. All my life I've been taught that. Give to the poor. And all of a sudden I hear Jeremiah telling me that the poor are those without understanding? Oh, crap. That's a different meaning.
That ties right in.
That changed. That really, that had a huge impact on my life.
Exactly.
Because everything in my life had been geared to this idea of the poor being those with no coin in their pocket. Everything was always, you know, well, I got to go down to the poor end of the city to preach. Well, maybe it would have been a good idea if I'd been up at the big shots end of the street preaching. Might have been a better place to be. Not to say that it wasn't good to be down with the poor, those with no money in their pocket, but you know what, you understand what I mean? It changed my perspective. That was just one talent God gave me, one verse. What did I do with it? Well, I turned around and I thought, well, wait a minute, you know, I read somewhere about two sides to wisdom. I got a computer, I look up two sides to wisdom. Yeah, there's two sides to wisdom. And I'm thinking, well, what are these two sides to wisdom? And I search and search and search because I want to increase my talents. And I discover that there's two trees in the garden, which I knew all along, but it just wasn't sinking in. And I recognize that, wait a minute, nothing that God says is close. God is not, when God shoots his bow, his arrows hit dead center. He doesn't have some of them that fly off to the side, you know, or miss the target, or, you know, they get a 25 instead of 100. You know what I mean? He doesn't do that. God is perfect. So I turn around, I'm reading about the two sides to wisdom, and I read about these two trees in the garden. They're both in the middle. How do you have two trees in the middle of God's garden? You don't. You don't. There isn't enough room. The middle of the garden is the middle of the garden. Have you ever taken a compass with a little picky thing that you used to poke the guy in the seat beside you in public school, you know? In the bum.
In the bum.
You take that little pointy thing and you stick it in your paper and you whiz your pencil around and it gives you a perfect circle.
Well, that kind of compass.
Show me the middle. Where is the middle?
Right in the middle, sir.
It's right in that little pinhole. That's the middle. And there's two trees there. That's impossible. Oh, but it's not impossible when you understand the two sides to wisdom. Same. Because suddenly, that one tree, if you read it from this side, you see the literal, the exoteric, the earthly, the unspiritual. The of the devil wisdom. But if you read it from this side, you see the heavenly, the spiritual, the truthful wisdom that comes from the tree of life. This is the tree of life. This is the knowledge of good and evil. You ever notice how people will talk an awful lot about wisdom? And they always associate wisdom with the knowledge of good and evil. And very few people ever bring to light the fact that there is a knowledge and a wisdom which God says is supreme, and it doesn't come from the forbidden fruit. It comes from the tree of life. And that Bible talks about it. And yet people have nothing to say about that. Oh, but they don't understand there's two sides to wisdom because they don't believe what they read when the Bible tells them there's two sides to wisdom. So they get this little talent. What do they do with it? Oh, I'm one born again, going to go to heaven. Praise the Lord. And that's all I need to know. I don't need that. Go collect dust somewhere. I don't need that. And if I do anything with this, I will sit down, any, mini, money, mo, I will open it up. That's amazing. And if you ask me 10 minutes after I've done that, I can't remember a thing of what I read or where I read it. And they say, I've read the Bible, Don't tell me I'm a liar. 40 years that was me. In playing religion. Playing with the whore. Diddling the monkey. That was me for 40 years in church. And then God tapped me on the shoulder and said, you sure you want to go to heaven, Ed? Because you sure love playing in hell. He gave me a talent. I told you last week. My first talent he gave me was Jeremiah 5 and 4. I'll even tell you how you'll never forget it. Do you remember a song years ago by a band, or it was actually a Christian rock band, called Three Dog Nights? And they sang a song called Joy to the World. And in that song, part of the lyrics is, Jeremiah was a bullfrog, dun, 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 was a good friend of mine, dun, dun, dun. Couldn't understand a single word he said, but he sure had some mighty fine wine. The Jeremiah they're talking about is a Christian rock band, is the Jeremiah in this book. Always remember the song, the bullfrog song. Jeremiah was a bullfrog. Now, because we're in the Tri-Town area of the great district of Temiskaming, and there's a town within the Tri-Town called Haileybury, and the Haileybury has an old-timers hockey league. And the old-timers hockey league's name is?
I don't know.
Lions, I don't know.
No, they're not that old.
Okay. The old-timers hockey league's name is the Haileybury 54s.
Oh, yeah.
All you time. Have heard of it.
Yeah.
Jeremiah 5 and 4.
Oh, there you go. It's
an
association here.
Learned by association. Yeah. So the bullfrog song and the hockey team. And you'll always remember where to find the poor.
Just sticking with the talents, that was interesting was the cold. You should have taken what you've got and place it with the bankers.
Place it with the bankers. Now you got something from it. Who are the bankers? Yeah. Who are the bankers? Remember that you're talking about the talent?
Those who
the parable of the talents.
The Jews. Those who multiply the talents.
Those who multiply the talents.
Yeah. The investors.
People who you might be in a group where there's a couple of individuals in the group. Let's take our little group. Who are they're writing a book called Bestiary. They're looking for information. And you're reading something in the scriptures, and you run across some strange little thing like the door. The door to the temple. That's an interesting one to think about. You know, the door to the temple. What's that? We're the temple. We're the body of Christ. We're the bride of Christ. We're the temple. What's the door? And you think, well, any ideas?
Either the mouth or the
what the door could be?
And I'm gonna go on there, I'm not sure.
You got it.
The door of salvation.
Door of your mouth.
Oh, right.
David tells us that.
Shalom. See you guys later.
You gotta go? Yeah. Nice to have you again, Justin.
Thanks, Ed.
Glad to see you every time. Take it easy. You still at McDonald's?
Yeah.
And I'm loving it.
And he's loving it.
See you on Thursday.
All right.
This cold and hot, actually, when I read that before, I would think of cold and hot, and it's because of the vomit you out of my mouth. Think of coffee, because you have like your coffee hot or iced coffee is pretty good. Mm-hmm. But when like this coffee kind of tastes like crap right now.
Let it cool off.
Well, it's in the vomit. Normally, though, if I go to Timmy's or whatever, it takes me a while to drink my coffee.
Too hot.
Throw it in the... No, like if it gets cold.
Oh, I see. Okay.
I'll put it in the microwave. Don't like lukewarm coffee. Well, that's always what I...
was thinking, yeah.
Thinking just from the... Just because the next line of spitting you out of your mouth. I don't know, coffee was...
They
serve a purpose, both of them, though. Like, coffee, it's cold day, or you just like hot coffee. Iced coffee, though, in the summer, you want a coffee, but you don't want to overeat.
Yeah.
Lukewarm just sucks.
I love a nice cup of tea any time of the year. That's my favorite.
Yeah. That's a really good point, though, where it's like, look, you take something that has a purpose to either warm you up or cool you down, and now it's in a state that just isn't right. So again, you know, this idea of this lukewarm individual, they've got all the bits and parts, they've seen all the evidence, but they want nothing to do with it.
Nothing to do with it. No.
I'm happy say this lukewarm would work with a woman.
Right?
Lukewarm woman.
Yeah. If she's hot, she can warm you up. If she's cold, you can warm her up. If she's lukewarm, nobody's warm. Nobody's doing
nothing
anything.
Gets done.
Nothing gets done. I agree with you. Is
thing.
That right, Heidi?
What's the same thing?
The way I was
is that right?
The way he's saying it's almost the same. It's just the hot. The only difference is he thinks cold is different than I think what cold is. But it doesn't. It's still. He's still saying lukewarm is bad.
Well, Jesus says it's bad, didn't he?
Yeah,
he said he's going to spit us out of his mouth.
Lukewarm is bad.
Yeah, I was always taught that in church.
Yeah, it's just, he's associating...
It doesn't matter what hot...
He has two bads. He's associating lukewarm and cold as bad.
Well, cold's not bad.
I know, cold isn't bad. That was the whole point.
We can't...
Is that the only scripture, though? Is that, like, when it says hot and cold, that's where we get it, eh? Right here?
Mm-hmm.
There's not another scripture?
Talking specifically about this...
The talents. We just gave you another example. Read the parable of the talents. That illustrates that whole
story, only it's not saying hot and cold.
Right. Hot, neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other.
He wishes, that's the point. He wishes that you were either cold. Let's start with cold. Either cold.
Start with wishing.
Jesus, exactly. Jesus would like that you be cold. How is that a bad thing? Jesus would like that you be hot. How is that a bad thing? Neither is bad. I wish you were cold.
Either for me or against me. Where's that book of scripture? Either you're for me or against me. Is that in the
Bible?
Yeah,
but that
has nothing
to do with what
he's
saying here.
But that's exactly what he meant. It's the same thing.
No, it's not.
I believe it is.
I don't think so. He doesn't say, I wish you were against me. He says,
that's
you
right.
are either you're,
for
you
me.
Are
either
for
me or against me.
He doesn't say, I wish
There's
you
no
were
three
against
there.
Me.
But either way, it still says don't be lukewarm.
Yeah,
it means
no.
the same bloody thing.
No,
it's totally
what he's saying is it's been explained that cold is bad and lukewarm is bad.
I was never taught. I was just taught don't be lukewarm.
Yeah, that generally is teaching.
Don't be lukewarm, Dan. Don't. Well, you can be cold or hot.
Really cold.
we should be on fire for God.
Yeah,
if the spirit of fire is in us. If the spirit of fire is not in us,
I think it was used as a metaphor, more or less we should be hot for God.
Backpedaling a little bit, going back, so again, hot and cold, but I have an observation, and this might be applicable here, maybe, that I noticed that people who have the spiritual eye, or ears, or eyes, are the extremely high intelligence is not doing a favor for waking up spiritually. I noticed that average people are best, but even below average people with their intelligence are more likely that they, because it's not IQ, the intelligence from the left hemisphere that has anything to do. There's another type of intelligence which I don't have a word for, but that if it wakes up, and I believe it's if it wakes up, it's because the spirit has chosen you to wake up. Now that is another type of intelligence, and you can see things with that,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to your left brain intelligence. You
doesn't
know what I mean? There are two intelligences. Like, look at the leaders; they're super intelligent.
Sure.
Almost all of them, but they're so stupid.
Yeah.
Now they lead us into ashes.
Yeah, that's true.
So that's what
some people are so they're so smart that it's
they
unbelievable.
They finished Harvard,
stupid,
they finished MIT. They come from all over Ivy League universities,
mm-hmm.
but they're ruining everything.
They possess the knowledge of good and evil.
Mm-hmm. They excel in that.
They excel in it, but they have no idea about the knowledge that comes from the tree of life. This is why I tell people: if you get cancer or you get really sick or you need medical help, Don't go mess with doctors. Go mess with Christians.
What?
Find a doctor who is a God-fearing Christian. He'll be able to help you. Find a doctor, I don't care how big his reputation is. If he's not a God-fearing Christian, he will do you no good at all. He will, in my case with my wife, five of them, they killed her. They killed her. I made a mistake. I didn't practice what I preach. I trusted a bunch of people, and I didn't come out and in their face ask them. I did not put them up against the wall and say, what God do you serve? Tell me now before you touch my wife. Because if you don't serve my God, you ain't touching my wife. I should have been smart enough to do that, and I didn't. Now I tell everybody. I tell everybody, if you need help with a medical problem, God provides the wisdom. All wisdom comes from God. And, you know, there's marvelous medical miracles today as compared to just when I was a kid. Polio was running rampant when I was a boy. My friends got polio. Some of them died. It was, that doesn't happen today. Things have changed, you know what I mean, as far as wisdom has come. There are people out there who can help. But I'll tell you something, if God's not in a man, no matter how much wisdom he has, he will not help. He will not be of assistance to you. You're just wasting your time and your money playing with those guys. Don't go near them.
I've got a scripture verse just to support exactly what you're saying. It's in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise of the world, of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. So here, you know, here's a perfect example. And you're right. You're absolutely right.
Hot and cold.
Hot and cold, isn't it? Yeah, yeah.
Hot
and cold.
Yeah. Hot and cold. I thought of a scriptural person who would, I think, meet the description of cold. Yeah, Mordecai, Esther, from the story of Esther. He did everything right, but he's in the shadows, kind of. He didn't want anyone to see it. And look what happened with Esther, and she...
She swung the sword. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. No, the hot and cold.
That's a good example.
It's really important that everyone understand that, because, like I say, there are some really cruel and evil beliefs taught in Christendom concerning hot and cold. They're not of God at all. They're of the devil. They're absolutely.
All the churches.
They put people in categories. We've got a little group of 10 people. Can you imagine being the pastor of a church of 10,000 people?
Yeah.
And you're going to have an awful lot of very different characters.
Yeah.
Very different demographs of what's out there in this 10,000. You're going to have some who are drug addicts and addicted. You're going to have some who are doctors, some who are
extroverts, some introverts.
Extroverts, introverts, retarded kids, adults. You're going to have people in wheelchairs. You're going to have people. 10,000, your whole gamut. And I have listened to men stand in the pulpit and say things about the God, about God. And I'm telling you, I'd be so tempted to run up there and stop it. Because they're just destroying people. People in the audience are sitting and associating what's coming out of this prick's mouth. And it's just tearing them to pieces. Not to build them up in God, but to tear them down, to rob their temples, to make them feel like shit. And this asshole's up there in his $1,000 suit, preaching this bullshit. They need to, Paul said, they need to be silenced. They're destroying whole households. They are crucifying Christ Jesus himself. Because just because some poor soul is addicted to something, or just because some poor soul is it has some kind of affliction.
Yes.
An affliction.
In the flesh.
Just because of that, that makes him less than you or I? I don't think so, Tim. And don't you dare teach no bullshit that makes him less than what he is. He's just as valuable. He's just as important. He's just as righteous or unrighteous as you or I.
I don't know if you were there last year in the fall. We had our pastor talk about the sin of man in general. So you know, not that there isn't any, there is many, but you know, it's I intervened and I said that someone, I had a little argument right there, that it is there is nothing, we don't need judgment of those and keep repeating it and feel
right.
You know, like
fleecing the flock. Yeah. You know, think about what Jesus said, right? When you do these to the least, or when you've done them to the least of these, the cold, you've done it unto me.
Yeah.
This is when he was bringing the goats, the hypocrites, into judgment. I mean, another hot and cold. I mean, the evidence is overwhelming. But you're right. People will sit there and they get a power trip by beating the moral drum. You're a piece of shit. You're not good enough. You don't do enough.
Not with us today.
It's not a blanket statement, Dan.
No, I know.
It does happen. It
I know
does
you're
happen.
Getting that.
Yeah.
You read the book of cut his hair.
Samson. Yep.
Oh, you'd be cold, like really cold, because you had talent and he gave it all up. So you'd be cold, right? You'd be the coldest man. The Bible probably still went to heaven.
Samson? Samson judged Israel.
Yeah, he wasn't cold.
He led Israel.
You're thinking of when they're talking about the talents, you're thinking of talent as in like a skill. Talent is money.
Knowledge, right? Like
the riches, the talent, if you're looking at it from the worldly perspective, is money. But when you look at a talent from the spiritual perspective, it's the wealth that God gives us, the riches that God gives us. The riches that God gives us are not money. The riches that God gives us is wisdom. Solomon taught that all through all of his books. I mean, Solomon wrote the Songs of Solomon, Ecclesiastes, Proverbs.
What's that?
The word isn't supposed to be confusing either, so why isn't it wrote like that? Hot and cold, I was never taught that way, and I don't think there is a church that ever taught it
that way. Well, it's not confusing because we kept bringing out different examples. The Bible keeps repeating itself.
It makes sense. The only reason why I agree, because you said lukewarm was bad. It is bad.
Yeah.
But
you also said that you were taught it.
That wasn't taught.
That's where it gets confusing. Yeah.
I know a young man who, very intelligent young man.
It's a metaphor for, I believe it's a metaphor for being good or bad. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. Don't be lukewarm. It's the same thing, really. But is there any other cold and hot in the Bible? Or is that the only place?
Well, three of them so far.
Yeah, three so far. The parable of the talents. Christ judging the...
Hot and cold on it?
Yes.
Hot and
well, it doesn't use that those
that's
same words,
for.
Dad. Well,
what does it mean to be hot?
Like,
what does it mean to be on fire for Christ? To be hot for Christ. What does that
it's
mean?
It's a metaphor.
It's exactly it. It's a metaphor.
Yeah.
So if hot and cold is a metaphor, then how many other metaphors can you find in the scriptures that mean the same thing? And what Pat was explaining was the story, the parable of the three boys with the talents, that the king gave them talents and went away, and what did they do with their talents? That's a metaphor for the same thing as hot and cold. What was the other one?
Christ judging between the sheep and the goats.
The sheep and the goats, that's Matthew 25.
Yep.
And it's a metaphor for the same thing.
First Corinthians, those who are wise of the world,
yeah,
versus the what the world considers to be fools.
That's right. So there's a wisdom of the world, but then there's a wisdom
think
of God.
About it, Dan. It's not that Jesus doesn't come and take your temperature. Oh, he's boiling. He's his blood's boiling. He's hot, or he's turning blue. He's cold. Not talking about that, right?
It doesn't really matter. But the metaphor is just don't be lukewarm. Like, try not. I think he's talking Christians in general. Maybe you're right. Like in the Christian world, not the earthly world. If you're a Christian, it's either like, okay, there's some Christians, like you said, that are like really high in the pulpit, and there's some Christians that are in the back. But if he's really like,
he loves them both.
If you think
that's
of it, like in the Christian world, we're all Christians, but every one of us are different. There's not one Christian I know that's the same.
Yeah.
There's everyone's different. We all believe in different things, but one God.
Dan, I want to touch on something you said. You said the word isn't supposed to be confusing. It's not. But it says in here in a few different places that they would place a stumbling block. They'd stumble over him. That is Jesus.
Who is
Jesus
the word?
Is the word. On top of that, even like, say, at the Pentecostal church, there's a lot of different views inside just that one building. Then you gotta add, there's 10 churches in this small town. Then you think of the world, and there's like 30,000 denominations. If the Bible's not confusing, we wouldn't have 30,000 denominations.
And who's confusing it?
It's
shepherds.
Yeah, exactly.
The Bible's alive and it has so many different meanings.
How many shepherds do you think we should have? Just
shepherds?
An offhand question. How many shepherds do you think we should have?
No.
Or it's God, but really we should be led by a shepherd, which is
God.
Or, well, I say my pastor, they're our teacher.
You know what God says about the pastors and the teachers of the... Do you know what he says about
it? I agree
with
God being our shepherd. He is our shepherd.
Yep. He says it'd be one flock, not many, one flock and one shepherd. And that shepherd is Christ Jesus, and that flock is the body of Christ.
Different churches. Just
so,
different
no different churches.
One body.
My dad
one body, one flock.
Ever.
If Jesus is the Word come to life in flesh, should not all of us understand the Word exactly the same way?
It's one Word.
It's one Word.
It's one God.
It's one God, and it's one Christ.
One faith.
One shepherd, faith. One faith. Not many.
Not many.
Believe me, the whole idea. Why did the denominations come to birth?
I would like to insert here that let's not forget who's the prince of this earth. And as long as we keep ignoring this fact, because it's inconvenient truth. It's an inconvenient truth, like Al Gore said, about something else. You know, it's inconvenient, but there is another God. There is another God. Jesus said he is a God. As long as you don't want to talk about Satan and the dark forces, you are not getting it, man. That's what I see. Anywhere I look, they're trying to avoid because it's negative.
Mm-hmm.
But as long as you don't acknowledge that,
he remains hidden.
You're not evolving, you're not getting to the point.
Yeah.
So how is this connecting? Well, because the word and the interpretation of it is got corrupted with this king, God prince, right?
Yeah, sure. The shepherds.
And now this area, this world, this planet, or dimension, however you watching it, doesn't matter, it's ruled by that king. That prince.
Falsehood.
Ignoring the real one. He's the ruler, ignoring the real one. Right? So.
He wants to play God.
He wants to play God.
He always wants to.
So he's corrupting everyone who he could corrupt. Every human.
Satan wants to play God.
So the whore, right? She sits upon many waters.
Mm-hmm.
It's not singular.
Nope.
It's many.
Many waters.
Many, many, many.
The waters of peoples, multitudes, nations, and languages. And the whore sits on many waters. She's everywhere. She's everywhere. And she is a prostitute. She's a dirty, diseased poor. And she is organized religion.
And there is no army in the world that ever not analyzed their enemy, you know, or defined who is my alliance and who is my against me.
Yeah.
And then go forward. How many of them? What's their power? What's their virtues and what's their weaknesses? You have to know your enemy.
Yeah, sure.
You have to know Satan.
How do you fight an enemy that nobody talks about?
Nobody talks about and not.
Nobody explains the lake of fire. Nobody explains the difference between heaven and hell. Nobody explains the difference between hell or Hades and the lake of fire. Nobody explains the difference. No one explains the soul. Oh, well, we really don't know what the soul is. What, you didn't read the book? You didn't read the book? The soul, goodness sakes alive. The book explains the soul to a T. All you need to do is believe what it says. But they don't want to do that. Nobody's telling anybody how to fight the devil.
Those who are
demons. What are demons? Everybody even in the pulpit. Demons are Hollywood.
Could be a pastor.
Sure, could be a pastor, could be a person in the pew. Could be a mother, could be a father, could be a son. Anyone who chooses to not recognize the truth, right? Who rather be deceived by the devil, falsehood. Like, I mean, so it we all possess this potential.
Right.
Doesn't matter who you are.
And again, remind yourself of that intelligence I was talking about. If that is not present, then it's so easy with this brain to get confused and get lost and get to be a prey for Satan.
Sure.
I'm a talker.
Remember, Danny understands what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Don't forget that. You know.
I ask questions.
Dan's just asking questions.
Yeah,
nothing
questions.
Wrong with that.
No. I'm going to ask questions about this too.
It is good. It's good too because let it not be shocking.
Like,
sure.
No, I don't know. I want to, like, is it, it doesn't really, lukewarm is lukewarm. But I want to.
Hot and cold, do you grasp it now?
He's got the idea of it. Let him.
Yeah. Okay.
Let him sit on it. That's good. It's. We're not.
Force feeding.
Believe it. Yeah. Not against you. I understand completely. I understand your points and the struggle in life that you go through. I understand where you're coming from. All we're doing is just, you know. There's a lot of really good. Sound teaching in the Bible.
First youth rallies I went to, it was an overnighter, and Pastor Douglas was the pastor at the time. He was given this, and his whole sermon was about hell, I remember, and it was quite interesting. I don't remember it, but it was pretty good. He did teach us about hell. So it was taught in the church. It's... Where are we supposed to go? There's no churches that... You can't...
Well, there's nothing wrong with having
organized
churches.
Religion, we got to find a sanctuary, because if we don't, are we supposed to keep our...
How do we fellowship?
How do we fellowship?
You know, if Pat, this is a church. Pat
it's
opens his home to folks to come in.
It's not a church.
This is a church. Where are the church?
Where two or three are gathered.
Where two or three are gathered, that's the church of God. It's not a building. So I'm not criticizing the fact that folks have a building where they gather together. They call it a church, but it's the gathering that's the church.
It's
the
people.
The
it's the people that matter.
Yeah, the church.
Exactly.
I'm from Europe. I grew up until I was 25. You haven't seen churches that I have seen. You know, the building-wise.
Yeah.
Are those the churches? I thought so. Once my other intelligence opened up, I realized... This is a church.
The people are.
Sure.
I can sit with him in Tim Hortons, and we have a church now.
Yeah.
And all that. I.
What about the two men who are in?
That's
Dan. You're going through the hot and cold thing.
No,
But he says
you are one lucky girl.
He says you're lukewarm, right?
I saw that
in the next verse. He says, so he's talking to the people here who are lukewarm, and he says, you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing. So I guess these people are looking at the money they have, they think they're wealthy, they know everything, but they don't know that you do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. And then he goes on to say, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you can be rich, and white garments that you may be clothed. So this gold refined in the fire is the word here. And the lukewarm people, they're not digging in the gold in here.
And I'm going to get the nuggets.
Can I ask you a question? Anybody have any mineral mining expertise? How many times do you refine gold to get pure gold? How many times do you refine it?
Oil, right? Like the crude oil. It's incredible, especially if it comes from sand. It's incredible how long it has to be refined to
be useful.
Useful for gasoline.
Gold has to be refined 7 times. Count the candlesticks. Count the demons that came out of Mary Magdalene. Gold has to be refined 7 times to make it pure gold. And the Lord says in His word here that Joshua just read, He says, I counsel you to buy for me gold refined in the fire. What's the fire?
It's a testing.
It's the furnace of affliction, isn't it?
That's truth.
Isaiah taught us that. It's the furnace of affliction.
Yeah.
It's where the truth is revealed and we pass through. It doesn't harm us. The truth can be revealed and it'll do great harm. Or the truth can be revealed and in our acceptance and our submission to God, we pass right through. It doesn't harm us. Remember, he talks about the sun and it won't hurt us, but it'll scorch men. But it won't hurt us. The sun is, according to Malachi,
okay,
is the sun of righteousness. Jeez. It doesn't rise in the east, it rises in the north.
So it's not talking.
The north is the land of maturity. It ain't talking about the land of authority, it's talking about the land of maturity in the Word of God. And this sun rises in the north. And it's the sun of righteousness. Not S-O-N, S-U-N. Sun of righteousness. And it'll be so hot,
which is
hot, it will scorch men, and they'll curse God because of it.
I don't know if you guys do that, but I always turn north when I pray. When I go down on my knees and pray, I always turn. I always want to know where north is and pray that way.
Yeah,
because I read it.
It's interesting.
I don't know. I never considered it myself, but it's okay.
Like in that reflection of maturity,
a very comfy chair. And I was at the hospital, you know, the place there where the sanctuary at, and those chapel place there was fun. So I went there and sat in the chair for a while, and then I said, I'm going to try kneeling on that thing. I didn't think it was for the, it must be Catholic, and I grabbed a French Bible. My God, I'm getting bad at my French. Hey, you know Revelation, what it means in French? No, it's like apocalypse. That's what it says in French. And me and Rebecca were like, whoa, what's this? This is cool. Is that what it says?
Yeah.
I found that so funny. It's French. It said, like, I tried reading some scripture. I went Jeremiah 29:11. I'm trying to read that in French. It's like two scriptures, like very, very short compared to English. For I know the plans I have for you, declare the Lord, plans to prosper you, not harm you, plans for hope and future.
In French, eh?
In French, it's short. Very short.
Awesome.
I don't know how to speak French.
And I had a hard time. I'm like, what does that word mean? It's like so different. And I was raised French. My first Bible was a French Bible. Catholic,
yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's all right. They're helping you.
We got a mosey on me.
We didn't get too far into organized religion.
We just touched the end. We'll go back. We're going to go back in again.
Yeah, I am the church.
We all are. I know. You're thinking of really, really attacking Church.
I never said that.
No, but it feels like that's how you're taking it.
If we're going with this spin, it will take two evenings.
Not to get it down, but he's.
That's all right. We can only move as fast
as it goes.
The weakest link. You know what I mean?
What's that?
The chain is only as strong as its weakest link. So you know, as a group, we can only move as quickly as the slowest one pick up on. We can't all talk to the people at Corinth there and said, you know, don't you have homes to eat and drink in?
All right, we'll see you guys later.
We're talking about food. No. We're talking about the scriptures, you know, he said, don't be big. Don't buy those.
So
we don't understand.
Bye, Amanda.
Bye.
Okay, bye.
I lost the French language. I'm pretty bad at it.
It's so much different than the English Bible.
And it was this big. You look at the Bible at the hospital there, you go at the thing, it's like this big, and it's Jerusalem. I don't know, it's really different. It's really big. It's different. I don't like hospitals, but I went to visit friends.
No, I don't think so.
I gotta be there tomorrow at 30 or 11.
He's taking a call. I'll be happy.
Check on my heart here. Hopefully it's okay.
Oh, wow, right?
Yeah, that's a so
you have to take care of trash there?
No, I don't know
what
I'm
doing.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know what you're doing. Some of the thing there. Right? Same place you go for a actually, I guess I don't know. Check on
the ground.
I don't know what they're doing. I just want to make sure my.
So, do I press stop?
You can, or you can leave it on. It doesn't matter. I've got it plugged in, so.
Oh, okay.
I'll just cut it off anyways, whatever we don't use.
Dad?
What?
What was
that? Oh, the verse. So, Ava.
Ava
yes.
Wants to explain something to her teacher.
His her teacher is telling her that God is two people. That there's
three.
That God is three people.
Oh.
Right. Well, it's not the same.
Which school is it?
It's a Catholic school, which they wouldn't teach that normally. It's just that the teacher doesn't understand that God is one. So she wanted a verse out of the Bible to kind of show that.
Isaiah 44:6 and Revelation 1:17-18. And if that doesn't wake her up, nothing will.
Ah, okay. Well, I was thinking John 16. Wait a minute. John, where am I? In John, basically where it says, the disciples are asking, please show us the Father. If we see the Father, we'll be satisfied. And then Jesus says, I've been with you all this time, and yet you don't recognize me. If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. But
granted, it's good evidence. I'll always remember that evidence today. They think that God is an attitude of man's intellect. So God is a behavior. God is a unity in spirit of man. Man's spirit. That's what they think God is. So they think that verse is telling us Jesus is just telling them that, you know, God's in me, you know, I'm a good guy, and I'm behaving myself, and if you do it, God will be in you too. God is not anything to do with man. God pre-exists man. God created man. God didn't need man to show that he is a living being. You know what I mean? And that's
where
they screw it up today.
Misused, yeah.
Isaiah 44:6 and Revelation 1:17-18. Read it for sweetheart.
He needs a man so that people can know him.
Whether people know him or not doesn't change the fact that he exists.
I don't know.
If it's nice that people know him, I'm not saying it's not. But just our knowing him makes no difference to him. He still exists. He's still
whether or not we exist, he still exists.
Under the water, there might be a new fish that no one found. I thought.
And if we find it tomorrow,
it exists.
Mm-hmm.
But don't see it. Just because you haven't found it doesn't mean it doesn't exist.
That's true.
What is it again, Ed? Isaiah?
Isaiah 44 and 6. I'm pretty sure it's 44 and 6.
And what was the other one?
Revelation 1, 17, 18.
1, 17?
Yeah.
18.
I-S-A-I-A-H 44.
I'll give you two more.
Did you send a thank you to Ed for bringing those? Mommy
forgot
to put them on the table.
Thank you for bringing them.
Mom,
can I
grab
them?
Can I read it to you, honey?
Oh. Yeah. Hey, listen up.
This is Isaiah 44 and 6. This is what the Lord says, Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord Almighty. I am the first and I am the last. Apart from me, there is no God. That's the Old Testament, and that's pretty cut and dry. Apart from him, there is no God. Revelation 1, 17. When I saw him, now in the book of Revelation, I'll give you one more verse to tell you that, show that I'm not lying, I'm telling you the truth. This is the angel of Jesus talking to John. Okay, so this is Jesus talking to John. When I saw him, this angel, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and he said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and I am the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys to death and Hades." Old Testament, God Almighty, the first and the last, no other God. New Testament, Jesus, the first and the last, no other God. So if she thinks there's more than one God in heaven, she's mistaken.
So look, Isaiah 44, 6.
There's over,
so there's a marker.
There's over 30,
so read that.
Scriptures.
And then Revelations, Apocalypse.
They're just as powerful as that.
7 jusqu'à 18.
I mean, anybody, okay. I mean, even the Roman Catholic Church, they believe in the Bible. They believe it is the inherent word of God. So, but do people believe it? Sometimes it's just that no one ever showed them. You know, it's not a matter that a person's an antichrist or anything like that. It's just that no one ever loved them enough to show them. So, we show them
all to be seen.
We show them. I didn't know if it would come off or not. I didn't want to tear on you because I know you like it.
We forgot to put out the big donuts. Yeah. Not that long.
Where's Dan?
I mean, he just left about a year and a half.
But I just have to say, and this is what I'm chewing, whether or not I should say this. I feel so strongly that he's much like Judas, like he's not to be
give him time.
Not
just
to
give
be
him time.
Trusted. Like he's the lukewarm. If you know what I mean. I'm not saying because I wanna say anything wrong with him. You know, he has a lot of troubles and I know a little bit that his family is not blessed, but when I hear he speaks, I'm so worried for him and also that he's not someone who...
But for everyone that you worry about, the thing is he's coming out all the time. And, you know, it's good to have someone to bring sometimes the perspectives that are traditional, if you will, mm-hmm. and to be able to open up the opportunity, if you will, to look at what the Bible has to say. And I mean, you know, you need everything. How can I say, often, even in error will give contrast to the truth once the truth is revealed, right? So we never, how can I say, it's like there's no shame in not getting it right. what really matters is coming to an understanding of what the word says to be true. And even sometimes, you know, somebody might walk away and just they can't seem to accept what the Bible has shown us to be true, yet like Ed was saying in the beginning, it won't leave that person. It'll either, you know, eat away and do the work that it's supposed to do. And it may bear fruit. It may bear fruit much, much longer. Hey, Brother Ed.
It'll either destroy you or it'll deliver you.
10 years ago, maybe 20 years ago. It was probably 20 years ago. He would come and talk to me and point in our conversation, because I profess to be a Christian. He professed to be a Christian. I was operating a computer store, so we talk about God. He's talking about God from obviously the perspective that he understands, that is truthful. And I'm not rejecting it. Ed's a brother. I'm happy to see it, but I'm not getting what he's saying. It's flying right above my head because I'm entrenched in organized religion. I'm accustomed to what I've been told is truth. And, you know, I'm not really looking at the Bible for myself to understand God. I just believe whatever people tell me, right? And but yet, he says he's a Christian. I do love God. I mean, the reason I went to a church was because I remember there was a banner that said Jesus. And I just love Jesus, you know, Jesus is God. So if this banner, you know, surely there's got to be somebody who knows about God in here, you know. So you participate in this and that, but just to say, imagine if he would have gave up on me. It wasn't till, I don't know, 13 years later that those seeds actually grabbed root. So, you know, I as long as people are willing to converse, this is good. You know, the minute people are not willing, you know what I mean? They say you're dead to me, or shut the hell up, or you know what I mean? It turns into they want nothing to do with you. Well then,
you never heard that word?
Yeah, you never heard that word, son?
Yeah.
Then you've lost that opportunity to sow seeds, right? So that's always a positive thing. And you know what? I have nothing to hide anyways. Let's say, for instance, like a traitor, you know, kind of ideology, where he's going to go say, hey, you know, there's bad stuff going on in this house and they're trying to tear this and that up. Come on over. Come and have a seat. Grab a coffee. Let's talk. I got nothing to hide. I'm not, there's no conspiracy. There's no, we're not trying to uproot, you know, different churches or whatever. The truth is, like I said, I'll speak it anywhere and to anyone, you know, but it doesn't mean that it's going to bear fruit right away, right?
It's there.
It's there.
You plant the seed and you wait. The farmer has to be patient. He has to plant the seed and wait.
Sometimes really patient.
And water when you can. You know, maybe sometimes you have to heal your crop to give the roots a little more aeration, you know, make the potato grow bigger. And you wait. You patiently. You can't be impatient. You can't expect people to turn their backs on a lifetime of what it's been hammered into their heads. Mm-hmm. And you can't expect people to turn their back on that immediately, because it's just,
it's their own family.
It would hurt them too much, you know. But if you're patient, you plant the seeds. The seed is the word of God. You plant the seeds and you wait. And every opportunity you have, put a few more seeds in the ground. Give it a little more nourishment. Water it. Care for it. Love it.
What you mean by water is sharing it to people.
Hmm? How do you water people?
What you mean by watering the seed? The seed means like the gospel. And the water mean like sharing the gospel.
The truth wells up in us like a spring.
a spring is a place where there's a place on the ground and the water is just bubbling out of the ground. And it's pure and it's cold and it's good to drink. It won't harm you. It's good water. The more truth we bury in our hearts, the more we learn about our Lord, from our Lord, from His Word, then what's in us becomes like a spring of fresh water. And that water, of course, is the idea of a people who are like God and not like the devil. Do you know what I mean? People who are kind, compassionate, considerate, merciful, forgiving, in control, not out of control. This, you will find in your life as you grow up, you'll feel more comfortable hanging around people you can trust, people who are good water. You'll find that it's nicer hanging with people who you can trust. They're not going to hurt you. They're going to keep an eye out for you and protect you. They're going to wash your feet when you walk into some muddy pot, you know, where you shouldn't be. You know, they'll wash your feet. They'll get you out of that situation and get you cleaned up and get you home, you know, and you'll be safe. Those are the kind of people that you can trust to leave your front door open and your neighbor's not going to sneak in and rob you. You can trust to leave your car running in front of the store and nobody's going to steal your car. Well, we are not
a nice place to be.
In this world, we're not among those kind of people. But if we all met at my house, way out in the bush, one way in, you got to go across that creek, you want to get into my place, and there ain't no other way out. No other way out but that one way in. You could leave your car running there all day long, and every one of us would touch it. You could leave your wallet sitting on the dashboard of your car, and every one of us would touch it. I can leave my house open and we go for a walk in the bush. Nobody's going to touch anything in my house because we trust one another. We're Christians. Those are the kind of people you want to surround yourself with. When you surround yourself with bad company, it'll corrupt your good character. In other words, their badness will rub off on you and you'll start behaving like they behave, and that's not. We don't want our loved ones behaving like the world to that. It just isn't the way we do it. There's a reward. You know, you might think, people will tell you as you get older that the rewards of God have to do with financial reward, finding a wife who's... You understand that? A wife who's a slave? You don't want a wife who's a slave, do you? You don't want to treat your wife like a slave. You want to love your wife. You know what, Adam, he was lonesome in the garden and he didn't have anybody to be friends with, to have as a companion. Do you know where God took Adam, what God took from Adam? It says that he took from Adam a part. Some translations say a rib. That's okay. You know where the rib is, eh? Is right here, next to his heart. And you wonder why God takes something that was next to Adam's heart, is so that he could love it, so that he could protect it, and cherish it. And that's the way you want to grow up, to be like that, so that when you have a wife, she knows she's got a good husband. She's got a husband she can trust. She's got a husband who she wants to be with. And the same thing goes for a woman. You know, you want to find a good husband. Well, you want to hang with good people. If you want to find the good things in life, hang with good people. Don't hang with bad people. Don't hang with good people. And if you haven't got any good people around you, make them good.
How do you do that, Jeremiah?
You just somehow make them good.
You show them the Lord Jesus.
Yeah.
You teach them everything you can about the Lord Jesus. he'll change them. You can ask anything of God, God will give it to you. He'll give it to you. Scary part is that, you know, the Bible tells us not to pray for Antichrist. Lots of people do.
Pray for what?
Well, that's not a good thing. I don't advise praying for Antichrist, but
what's
some
Christ
people do.
Mean?
Antichrist?
Hmm? Yeah, Antichrist.
And mean? When they do, well, I guess there's a good reason for the millennium, isn't there? A 1,000 years where Christ rules and reigns and the devil's not there, and then the devil's loosed again to take out the final refining.
What's
you know
Antichrist?
What I mean? What's an Antichrist? An Antichrist is someone who has heard and understood. That's the important part. They've heard and they've understood that Jesus is God himself in flesh and that love is his command.
That's Antichrist.
They deny that.
But
they don't believe that.
They don't believe it. They've
understand.
Heard it, they've understood the message, but they don't believe the message.
No.
That's Antichrist. So even your teacher at school who thinks that there's more than one God, some might say, well, that's Antichrist. No, that's not Antichrist. Because you don't know for a fact whether she's heard the gospel that we preach. How do you? You don't know whether she even understands it, but chances are she doesn't. She loves the Bible, and she knows the Bible, you know. She's trying to show you in that, and you can help her. I mean, you're going to be the greatest blessing. It's going to be absolutely amazing. You take her those two verses, be very kind, be gentle, and say, well, I looked these up for you, and maybe we could take a look at them together. And then show her Isaiah first, and then talk about that, you know. You're talking about God Almighty. We're talking about no other God but him. And then take her into Revelation and show her Jesus. I had said I was going to show you one more verse about that it is Jesus talking. And all we have to do, if we question Jesus,
that says yes.
And we'll go to the book of Revelation.
So you're John that says yes, and he did not die. He's open fire here, whatever. So I said, and says yes, he has a whole lot of shows, it's called that. And he says yes, he nous apporte la connaissance de Dieu, de la soirée de Dieu. Ça c'est de la pure or, quelque chose qui est précieux, tu sais. So il y a deux genres de sagesse. Il y a une sagesse qui vient de la terre. Puis il y a une sagesse qui vient de l'univers, de Dieu, de l'esprit.
There it is. It's in Revelation 22, verse 16.
Sounds nice, Lord. Maybe.
Is that your French Bible label?
This community is a lot of people.
It's kind of like Twitter.
Yeah.
It's
the French one.
Not, is the French one? Understands French.
Yeah, too.
It was in Revelation chapter 22, verse 16, or it's called in that Bible the Apocalypse, so
small,
chapter 22, verse 16.
French.
No, le Apocalypse.
Would you say
French?
No.
Yeah,
22.
What I mean is that.
Yeah, New Lister, no. Like Earlton, yes.
Okay, wait. Of course, 95% speaks English.
Yes.
But about those 100%, 60% also speaks French.
Yeah.
So about 60% French,
yeah.
And 100%.
46.
100% of them are also English, of those 60% French.
Mm-hmm.
But there's 40%, so it's only English. You know what I mean?
22, 16.
Yeah.
So
yeah. There are more, it's almost 50-50. There's a slight higher percentage of people who are Well, I'm see, like my last name is Niall. My dad's family's from Quebec, and actually both my mom and my dad's family's from Quebec. I have both French-speaking parents, so I would be considered my primary language is French. I just
which you spoke first?
French. And then that was my mother tongue. I was educated in French.
Just like when did you start learning English?
Must have been grade school. 5, 6. You did?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, maybe. But we were always around English. But my dad didn't speak.
So you see, yes, Jesus was talking.
So, you know, but we've
seen the whole book of Revelation.
It's
Jesus. It's the angel of Jesus who's showing John these Greek revelations.
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
When the angel then tells John in Revelation 1:17 and 18,
you probably heard
I am the first and the last. It's Jesus talking.
Saying there.
It's not English. Somebody different. It's Jesus talking.
Yeah.
French, you have to.
That's how we prove that. Revelation 22 proves it's Jesus talking in Revelation 1.
Oh, yes.
So that'll help your teacher a lot.
Jeremiah,
she'll love you for it. Go I to guarantee it. She'll love you for it.
The one on the north?
Because there's not very many people out there.
Right before the Phoebe.
That understand.
Right after the Phoebe.
You do.
Or what used to be.
You got one up on your teacher.
Just a little after Toyota.
You're going to be kind. She shares wisdom that she has with
after,
you.
Okay,
you're going to share a little wisdom that you have with her.
No.
That's
and
nice.
You spoke English or French?
Give to one of us. You know what I mean?
Same shit. However you are.
You'll be a
French.
Blessing to her, I guarantee
you. Oh, you don't?
She does. She does.
I understand.
She's so full of it. She not only understands it, she can speak it. She can read it. She can. Her dad, well, more than that, said, voulez-vous coucher avec moi?
Yeah.
And I said, yes. No. But, her.
Voulez-vous coucher avec moi?
Coucher? Hide and seek. But no, her father is in Zubik. Mm-hmm. So her main name is Zubik. Her mother is a Scot,
how are you gonna wake up tomorrow?
Which was like a Scottish accent, and
usually,
yeah,
Scottish,
big
sense. Usually,
I think so. Hey, honey, that's got to be for sure.
Well,
yes,
she's Scottish. Yeah.
To bed at
so,
10.
So the point is, she went to English school her whole life.
But you didn't wake up early.
So she's not, feels comfortable speaking in French, but she can. I mean, I don't get away with anything. She knows, she can hear it all.
Still
do certain things. Mm-hmm. Well, that's good, eh? Yeah, and you're walking around, you're getting.
Yeah.
But it's not.